you did to walk yourself to death. Would you shoot a hole in your own hand and drink your own blood if the only sign of life left was what was left of your own? Escape is essential. I flee to avoid capture, to temporarily outrun retribution. I strive to calculate the distance of time spent between the past and the future. I know it's just a futile attempt to manipulate the time I will spend stuck forever in this permanent limbo. Freedom is a solitary state of grace. It's an oasis glistening off somewhere in the twilight horizon, where the shackles that bind have been blown to bits by the bullet of a Tommy gun. But is anyone ever truly free if they can't avoid their own shadow? Is anyone ever truly free if they can't shake off their own bitter fantasies or brutal delusions? I feel as if I inhabit an insomniac's theater of dream states and nightmares. I feel as if I'm haunted by an army of vagrant ghosts and invisible enemies who stalk and make ruin everything in their wake. The desert where I've lived for the past 10 years, the desert speaks to the fugitive in me, a godless gunman, isolated, alone. I feel like an intercessor standing motionless, exiled to a dusty terrain, a twilight hell of my own making. I feel as if I inhabit a parallel universe where a primordial essence stalks patiently, eternally hunting. I feel as if I'm a mysterious apparition with a burning desire to obliterate everything and everyone, like a one-man holocaust of infinite destruction who renders the landscape not blood red, but burnt umber, a patina which speaks of the absence of color, the absence of life, that empty husk of an eternal hollow. The desert is a barren panorama from which all life has been leached. It weeps of desolation, of death. I feel as if I stand there, a man, a murderer, alone, imprisoned in thought, hounded as if by locusts, a numbing din, a deep subterranean rumble, a lifetime of despicable secrets, forever murmuring just out of earshot. And I am that man, that rose, that ruin. I'm ruptured. I feel like a magnificent wreck, a mirage located far south of no north, and in this enticing envelope of devil winds, if I look to you as I truly am, you would no longer be able to see me. I would have been blown away upon the desert shore. This battlefield where I am pitted against myself, against my memories and their recriminations, my brutality and its empty others. And from this stage, there is no fitful sleep. There is no relief. There is only unholy rest in which I tremble. I've been hostage by futility, treachery, aggression. I'm exhausted and numb. I wake again and again to be blistered by the sun, consumed in sand, and left alone to battle my shadow. How long will it take to walk yourself to death? He said, I am the oxygen. I am the oxygen that he breathes in. He said, I am the oxygen. I am the oxygen that he breathes in. He said, I was like a dirty white honeysuckle. He said, I was like the night, I was like the night, I was like the night running off like the night. Dawn slowly blisters through the night sky, a slice of dirty brown shredding a crack in the horizon. The sickly green-gray pus of another nuclear day transmits life-death rays to my brain, which accelerates my faded pulse and shoots through my bloodstream like a dirty bolt of static electricity, which bounces off the ceiling, making everything look hollow. Life-size ghosted images of what real once was. I'm not sure I know what real is anymore. I jolt upright like a reanimated autopsy whose motor functions failed after hours of neglect suddenly ferment and register shockwaves. I'm sleeping with his memory. I'm sleeping with his memory. I'm sleeping. If I roll my eyes far enough back in my head, letting just the sliver of white like a cracked crescent moon kiss the morning somewhere under my veiny bloodshot eyes, I'll zero in on him. And like a cheap five and dime storefront gypsy fortune teller, I'll read his last thought and it will scare the living shit out of me. He was like a sick shark, isolated in a prison of pain. His loneliness tasted of sand and sewer drains, of day-old beer and broken promises, of black eyes and bruised ribs, of bloody rags wrapped around his temple. He said he was soaking up the fallout from the body as battlefield. He said, the body is a battlefield. He said, the body is an experimental canvas. The body is a blood bank. The body is a punching bag, a carving board, a sack of pus and cum. He said he was trampled under by his own big black boots, stormtroopers kicking the shit out of the enemy within. He said he was just trying to wage a counteroffensive which would guarantee mutually assured destruction, not only against himself, not only against me, but aimed directly at that shell-shocked and battle-fatigued little boy who screamed for ceasefire in the bunker and wanted his mommy to kamikaze into the demilitarized zone, that uncharted territory where a part of him still lived, the part that cowered in the corner late at night, scared of ghosts. Scared of ghosts? Remember? Do you remember? Do you remember last fall? We were so defiant. We disappeared. Nobody knew where we were. Oh, there were rumors. There's always rumors. People always want to talk about something that takes their mind off their own petty existence. You know, I guess, even in our absence, we were bigger than most people are living full throttle. We went west, or was it south? Or was it south? But we went to the desert. We went to the desert. Wide open snake, wide open empty space, because we felt empty. And we needed to refuel. We need to go somewhere where the absence of life and the absence of death. We needed to go to a place where in that vast expanse of nothingness, everything was possible. Everything was allowed. Everything was ours. And people continued to talk, to tell their tall tales and make things up, curious as to what exactly happened out there in the desert, in the southwest. In the place where it speaks of the absence of life, the absence of death. And we agree that if you don't admit, that is, if you omit, if you don't admit, if you omit, if you refuse the necessary teeth, if you deny everything, well, they can blame you for anything they want. But if you omit it, if you deny the necessary details, it doesn't really matter what they fucking say. If no Polaroids exist, if no film exists, And after all, there was no blood on our hands. There was no bruises. There were no bodies left in the dust. Even our shadows had disappeared. And now, like the ex-mistress of a lunatic who's been on the lam for decades, I'm called in for questioning. I'm grilled about my participation in the perpetration of heinous crimes, too numerous to mention. But if you don't mention them, if you omit them, if you deny them, they really don't have much to go on, do they? And after all, how the hell am I supposed to remember what happened 28 years ago? I can't remember what I did last fucking night. It's like trudging through a vast overgrowth somewhere deep in the backwoods and dredging through the dirt of an unmarked grave, looking for clues to the evil that befell a mutilated corpse. I didn't mutilate that corpse. That was left rotting in the rain. Of course, the details get a little sketchy, and I attempt to stitch together a timeline based on random samples of circumstantial evidence, hearsay, cold hard facts. But the crusty wound in my memory bank is like a grungy gorge, almost too wide to circumvent. So, like any good psychic detective sworn to tell the truth, that which I cannot recall, I will simply omit, which in the end only ends up favoring the defense. And here we are. And the less said about the details, the better, because quite frankly, what I can't recall is best left buried with the mysterious relics of a lost remembrance form a toxic stew, which one day may erupt. But for now, I'm keeping my fucking mouth shut. And all you need to know is that the evidence presented before you now is indeed, at some times, perhaps, absolutely fucking murderous. There's blood on my hands. There's no bodies buried in the sand. I mean, they'll never find the body. If you deny, if you do not admit, if you own it, they can blame you for anything they fucking want to. Find the body! Find the bodies! Find the body! They'll never find his body. They'll never find his body. I saw him first! I saw him first in the post office, his face, a blurry scan on a yellowed piece of paper, his black eyes burning. He was smirking. He was defiant. It said, wanted for, but I can't remember what he was wanted for. But I wanted him. Oh, I wanted him even before I knew it was him that I wanted. I wanted him. You know, it was like getting lost in a lock group. It was like getting lost in a film group. Maybe I've just seen one too many late night black and white film noirs, like Strangers on a Train, Rope, Fire Walk with Me, Nightmare Alley, The Naked City, Gun Crazy, Double Indemnity, The Fugitive Kind. Vengeance is mine. Vengeance is mine. He thought I was an ideal reflection of who he thought I was, mirrored in the drowning pool of my own eyes, and he had beautiful eyes. He had beautiful eyes. Beautiful eyes which lie beautifully, like my own beautiful eyes which lie, as I drain them of everything but my need, my greed, my loneliness. He was like a hungry orphan. He was seeking relief in my cruel smile. I felt as if my lips were twisting around a man who he thought was him, but was merely a projection of me, my need, my greed. And I remember a time. I remember when he was reinventing himself again and again, picking up the derelict pieces of shattered dreams, making peace with the empty promises and endless threats before his violence and his malevolence was a magnetic firestorm, a spontaneous combustion of bloodlust and mistrust. He was like a punch-drunk bruiser, shadow boxing in the dark, punishing shadows and raping ghosts. He was hell-bent on murdering that invisible enemy, the killer inside of him that wanted inside of me. But the killer inside of me has a mind of her fucking own. And before I knew it, my hands were around his throat, and his neck was broken in three different fucking pieces. Now, maybe I just watched one too many late-night black and white film noirs. It was like getting lost in a film loop, like gun cruising, strangers on a train, rope, firewalk with me, the fugitive kind. Vengeance is mine. Vengeance is mine. And there comes a point where nothing seems to make sense anymore. Not anymore. I mean, not when you're beyond reason and whatever it once was, it no longer is, and we no longer are, and he is gone, and every word has been leached of meaning. And the more I think I know, the less I seem to comprehend. He never knew me. He didn't know me. How could he fucking know me? He only knew what I let him fucking know. You think he knew me? He doesn't know me. You think you know me? You don't fucking know me. You don't know me. How could you know me? You know only what I show you. He couldn't know me. Maybe I've just watched one too many late night black and white film noirs, like strangers on a train, the fugitive kind. Vengeance is mine. You could be next. You could be the next one to end up the vasectin and stuck in a trunk on the side of some shit-stained road. Because some sick and twisted little mama's boy can't get it up anymore on the mere flesh and bones alone. And he needs the blood, the life's blood. Oh, I can understand the need to slaughter. I can understand the need to slaughter, to murder, but why is it always the daughters? Why is it always the daughters of the mothers and fuckers that condemn men to murder in the first place that get slaughtered? And that mommy and daddy dearest, who probably abandoned the little boy while they were down at the local bar getting shit-faced and left him with a babysitter who was probably stoned on acid and finger-fucking herself off in the bedroom while talking to her boyfriend on the telephone, stoned on acid. And he's plugged in front of the fucking idiot box, waiting for mommy and daddy dearest, or the latest daddy, to come home so they could batter into submission and castration all the little boys that didn't want to grow up to be monsters, didn't want to grow up to be madmen, but we're just carrying on in the family tradition. And in some families, abuse is the tradition. Shut up. In some families, abuse and neglect is the tradition. And I understand little boys who wish they were never born at all, didn't want to be born when their abandoned baby psyches never wanted to be born. They didn't ask to be born, they're pretending they were born. They know, they feel like they were born to be fucking battered, born to become batterers, because they can take it as well as they can dish it out. They can take it like a man murdered in self-sacrifice. And it's no wonder it's always men that grow up to be rapists and serial killers and politicians and pedophiles and schoolyard snipers. That's an American tradition. Whose sense of self was probably castrated on the football field, where they were told to stop crying, don't be a sissy, act like a man, wear your Nike fucking swastika, don't be fucking weird, you're fucking weird. And they spent half their lives, and who can blame them, stuck in front of the idiot box or the video games, obsessed with Grand Theft Auto, Gods of War, Soldier of Fortune, Mortal Kombat, Manhunt, who have been programmed, to have been trained, their motor functions have been trained to pull the fucking trigger. Pull the trigger, West Virginia, Kentucky, Springfield, Oregon, Jonesboro, Arkansas, Moses Lake, Washington, Littleton, Colorado, Virginia Tech, Columbine. Don't blame Marilyn Manson on that shit. Bring me your teenage boys. I'll teach them what life is all about so they can live through it without having to kill anybody. And the only reason they're killing people is because they've been neglected and feel too fucking weird and have no one to associate with when they don't fit into this rap bullshit or this bad, lousy dance music or the Justin Biebers of the world, the ones that should be shot. Sacrificial lost lambs, suicided by society, white boys acting black, black boys acting blacker. They're only killing themselves. If you're ignorant enough to breed and you have teenage sons, you can bring them to me because I love playing mommy and I'm good at it. You better behave or you're going to be thrown out.
I love you, Lydia.
I don't give a shit.
You better respect and stop your love. Your love means nothing. Your respect is everything.
All right. You, one more word and you're out of here. All right, out.
Do you remember the night we met? It had been raining all week. The atmosphere was thick. It was oppressive. It was like a lead blanket crushing the lungs. Electricity was bouncing off your skin. You couldn't sit still. You were pacing like a condemned man on death row awaiting a stay of execution. It was our first date. So why did it feel like your last night on earth? You finally relaxed after a couple of shots of bourbon. Jim Beam, I believe, took the edge off. Your hands finally stopped shaking. I brought one of your hands to my lips. They smelt of cigarettes, of whiskey, and honey. Kissed your fingertips, the inside of your wrist. I closed my eyes and licked thick scar tissue, which crisscrossed up and down your arms, a roadmap of conflict and insurrection, bearing ancient bruises like mysterious hieroglyphs I wanted so badly to decode. You shivered and pulled away, smirking. You said, "Well, you were wounded in a hunting accident. You've been hunting for ghosts of a murdered past. Their devilish residue left a high-pitched howl that hurt your head. And when the voices got too loud, you said you'd pick up a knife and try to locate their tongue so you could cut it out to quiet them down, and you laughed again. You offered me another drink, eyes full of innocence, a gorgeous ruse which failed to mask your remorse, your humiliation, your longing. Christ, you're fucking beautiful." We crashed into each other like wounded soldiers, banging our bodies against each other as if we were trying to escape this fleshy prison, clawing at the walls that each other hid behind. Impenetrable barricades, shielding the remnants of our shattered youth, shell-shocked and slightly delirious, seeking refuge in each other's embrace. We found it there, desperate and in need of relief. Both of us haunted by the bodies we had piled up in the wreckage we could never seem to navigate our way out of. It was like a muttering minefield of crushed lovers we had left behind, broken in the dust and shadows, victims of our brutality and greed of our need. We knew it wouldn't last. We were both too battle fatigued. We were made raw by forever waging wars against an army of hungry ghosts, angry phantoms, pitching tantrums and laying blame as thick as black tar, turning everything into a blood-soaked combat zone, the front line drawn in red across the bedroom door. Both of us too damn stubborn to completely surrender to the other side, to fully submit or even admit that really we were our own worst enemies. And anyway, I'm sorry, but I'm not. That I auctioned off your car, that I sold all your guitars, that I set the bed on fire with your favorite simple liar. It was just another tragic day. I mean, I had a little time to waste, and yes, I posted all those shots of you compromised and naked. I mean, I'm sorry, but I'm not. That I shut down your accounts, that I hacked into your bank, that I screwed your boss again. I mean, of course, I told all of your fucking friends. I'm sorry, but I'm not. That I had to call the cops. I'm not the one who likes to narc, but when they set the trial date, I'll be very far away. Yeah. Do you remember? I'm sorry, but I'm not. What the hell did you expect? A merit badge for playing dead? Am I supposed to be a friend to such a fucker?
Really?
Late night lost in that haunted no man's land, stranded on the corner of Sunset and Occidental, the ghost of all those who could have been, should have been, leave a Vaseline smeared lipstick smudge on the rear view mirrors, bloodstained crack. I'm lonely as one left shoe. With a busted ankle strap pitched out the window of the Starlight Motel, there is no drug, and trust me, I have tried just about every drug. There is no drug potent enough to kill off that vision of him, that soured, honeyed tumbleweed of hair that smells of dirty sex and cigarettes. His kiss is burnt into my lips like a faded hologram, just slightly out of focus. And I keep reaching for his mouth, forgetting about how the night bled out, turning a beautiful angel into a beautiful corpse whose memory haunts. He's just a mirage. He's just a mirage. He's crushing me. Slowly rises like a desert rat. I must be lingering in and out of consciousness. The dream gods must be working. He's crawling on all fours. He's mustering the strength of dead men everywhere. He brushes up against me. He slinks into me. He sinks into me. He's in my skin. I move my lips in protest, but my breath has turned to dusk. My bones are hollow husks. I have a soft spot for him. I have a soft spot for him. Kisses on the razor's edge. Kisses on the razor's edge. Dry whispers, lips as thin as paper cuts. He's mouthing instructions, which I will fight with all my will. He's telling me to pick up the snub nose. Pick up the snub nose, a small caliber 45 revolver. Pick up the snub nose. Cool evening breeze kisses dirty feet. My tongue is swollen, preventing argument against his hypnotic pull. He pulls at me. This is his domain. This is his domain. Caretaker, the endless obsidian night, that gravedigger of crushed dreams, that mortician's reanimator of broken hearts. He's just a mirage. He's just a mirage. He's crushing me. Late night lost, stranded on the corner of Sunset and Occidental. All the ghosts of those that could have been, should have been, leave a Vaseline smeared lipstick smudge on the rearview mirror's broken glass. I'm lonely as one left shoe tossed out the window of the Starlight Motel. There is No trog potent enough to kill off that vision of him, that sour honey tumbleweed of hair that smells of dirty sex and cigarettes. I keep reaching for his mouth, forgetting about how the night bled out, turning a beautiful angel into a beautiful corpse. He's just a mirage. He's just a mirage. He's crushing me. For some reason, in this time now, we all have a lot of people that are dying. I mean, people are always dying, but it seems like this last year, we all have people dying. And I wrote this piece when my only living family members died within 3 months of each other from brain cancer. We have a lot of cancer where I'm from. They die very young. My father was 1 year older, my mother 4 years older. So I'm here now. And this is for the dead and dying. We all know them. And what do you say to somebody that only has 30 days to live? I mean, what can you say? That in this, the land of illusion, we're all just transitional creatures? That we're all just peeping toms at the keyhole of all eternity? That the past is only the present cloaked by invisibility, and the future is just a murmur of a memory we will never possess? That the great mystery is not that we were thrown down here at random between the profusion of matter and that of the stars, but that from our fleshy prison, we have created images powerful enough to deny our nothingness. We have forced our words into the mouth of the universe, a giant black hole turned inside out, tales full of sound and fury, madness and lust, signifying what? Signifying what? And we inhabit an insignificant planet, orbiting a minor star. We're lost in a galaxy tucked away in a forgotten corner of an unfathomable expanse. We come spinning out of nothingness, scattering stars, hoping that one day over the distant horizon lies an incredible lightness of being without being, where everything will just fall away. Everything will just fall away. It will dissolve into subatomic particles where sight and sound are replaced with a comprehension of matter beyond human comprehension. But we're just dust and shadows. We're just dust and shadow. Death is just the shadow. Death is just the shadow that follows the body. What do you say to somebody that only has 30 hours to live? What do you say? What can you say? That I won't forget. I won't forget. I won't forget you. I won't forget you. Do you remember? Can you remember how much beauty we possessed? It almost fucking destroyed us. How we wanted it all. We went for it, baby. That's right. It didn't matter. We went for it. We knew what the score was. In the end, we fought. Oh, we fought. Yeah, we fought with every fiber in our soul. We battled. The battles raged. There wasn't a fucking day that we weren't in battle mode. We knew who the enemy was. You gotta know who the enemy is. In the end, the enemy is always gonna win. In the end, the enemy is just death, its fucking self. And it's been one long death trip. It's always been one long death trip. And after all, in the end, that's what we're fighting against. It's a battle to the bitter end against the killing machine and their merchants of death. You've gotta fight to control your life. You gotta fight to control your death. A fight to the bitter end. You gotta fight against the spiritually bereft and their soul-killing bullshit. Because it's in the air. They poison everything. They've poisoned everything. They poisoned the water. They poisoned all food. They poisoned the soil. They poisoned you. They poisoned you. What do you say to somebody that only has 30 seconds to live? What can you say? Say that you win. You win. You will be king. For yours is the power and the glory, and this is your story. You'll be wearing a crown of invisibility, and nothing can stop you. Now you're free. You're free. This is the moment you've been waiting for your whole life. You can just ride off into the sunset now, both barrels blazing, laughing like a lunatic, leaving everyone and everything else behind in the dust. We're just dust and shadow. Death is just the shadow. Death is just the shadow that follows the body. Don't be afraid. There's nothing to be afraid of anymore. You're free. I'm right here. I'm right here. Take my hand. Take my hand. I won't forget you. You're not going to fade away. You're going to explode. You're going to transform. You're going to be like a dark night just riding into that endless night. And don't fear the night. Don't fear the night. Embrace the endless night, that deep black velvet caress. Just go. Just go. You want to go? You want to go? Do you want to go into the light? Then go into the light. Go into the light. You just gotta let go. You gotta let go. You gotta go with it. Just go with it. I'm right here. You don't have to fight anymore. There's nothing left to fight. You win. You win. You will be king. You will be king. For yours is the power and the glory, and this is your story. And you're gonna be wearing a crown of invisibility. We managed to force our words into the mouth of the universe. Tales of sound and fury, madness and lust, and you know what it signified. Words mean everything to us. Words meant everything to us. You mean everything to me. Don't be afraid. I'm right here. We're just dust and shadow. We're just dust and shadow. Death is just the shadow. Death is just the shadow that follows the body. We come spinning out of nothingness, scattering stars, and I won't forget. I won't forget you. I won't forget you. I won't forget. I won't forget. Thank you.
Thank you.